Friends, today's topic, educational research and sustainable development in Indian context. It's very interesting. And the last two words in Indian context made it more interesting. The whole gamut of the subject matter changes when we look at the educational research and sustainable development. Because when we look at the subject theoretically, it needs a different attention, and we just analyze the subject and try to know what is this in Indian context, then situation totally changes. As I think, I don't know what Professor Raghu was planning to present. The moment I just gazed the subject twice, thrice, four times, the very specific last two words, Indian context, appealed me most. And before we discuss it, I think that what is education? And what is research? What is development? What is sustainable development? And above all, what is Indian context? Friends, education, we know all, we almost all of us are from the field of education. The best definition of education which I have come across my reading, learning, thinking is given by Albert Einstein. Einstein says that education is what which remains when one has forgotten everything he has learned in the schools. Forgetting everything, then what remains? It is very important. When whatever we have learned and we forget it, then what remains? And whatever remains is the education. The famous scientist Albert Einstein says this. Vivekananda says that education is the manifestation of the potential already within a person. Our scripture says that Tamso ma jyotirgamaya vidya dadati vinayam. And all, it's all education. And when we analyze the subject in the context of India, Indian context, then we need to review all these definitions, inter alia definitions given by the educationist of the modern time. Friends, what is research? Research is... Is it search? No. It's research. Then something which is already existing, we know that things are there, but we reinvent it. How we reinvent? We look at the whatever is existing from different perspective, from different angle, in different context. And we reach to certain conclusions, or we refute or we confirm whatever we do. But that is research. It enriches our understanding. It develops our mind. And educational research, again. When I look at the term educational research, I was confused. Whether we are talking of educational research or research in education. Research in education is different thing. And educational research is different. When I just look at the topic, it is educational research, then perhaps I may, I I may be wrong at my interpretation. If I am wrong, please correct me in discussion. Every research is educational. Is there any research which is not educational? Every research educates us. Maybe it is in mathematics, maybe it is in physics, maybe it is in philosophy, in languages, in art, in culture. It educates us, it is educational research. It is different than the research in education. In research in education, when we talk, we would be talking about teaching methods, syllabus, pedagogy, learning attitude, personality trait for learning a particular trait, particular subject, particular skill. These are the researches in education. But researches in education makes a man and helps a man making process. But educational research certainly helps society. Research in education is one of the components of the educational research. And for that matter, I consider that whatever research is being done by any person at any level, it educates the person, it educates an individual, it educates the masses, it educates the society. And we need to educate the society very much as good as we need to educate an individual. Now the third term is development and sustainable development. Again, I would like to be corrected if I am wrong in interpreting the things. Development is an ongoing process. Development never ends. An incessant activity in human life is development. And as a student of statistics and mathematics, I may assign to it, development may be positive or negative. But can development be sustainable? Can it be considered at a plateau and it will remain at plateau, that at whatever stage it is, we need to maintain it as such? Had it been so, then society would not have been developed. We would not have been living a better life than what I think, a physically better life than what I feel that our ancestors have lived. And certainly the sustainable development is not a development which is only at a physical level. But sustainable development is a development in a positive direction which ensures that our future generation will also enjoy the gifts of nature equally as we are enjoying. We need to preserve, conserve the natural resources, the climate, the water for our coming generations. And if we overspend it, if we pollute it, if we destroy it, then it's negative. And perhaps we are doing injustice to our coming generations. So sustainable development means that maintaining the nature, maintaining the natural resources. I just quote an example of milking a cow is sustainable development. Milking a cow, for that we need to feed the cow also. We milk the cow, we leave sufficient milk in the udder of cow for his calf, so that cow also lives, calf also lives, and we also enjoy the milk. We cannot go in the direction of sone ki murgi wala, sone ke ande wali murgi, a hen giving a golden egg, and we just slaughter it to in order to get all the eggs simultaneously at one time, then what we'd be doing? We would just be missing all our future golden eggs. So sustainable development has to be interpreted in its proper form, where we ensure our future generation a good living, a comfortable living, a harmonious living, a peaceful living, a living for which Martin is aiming at, a peaceful world government. So sustainable development, when we look at, then in context of India, I don't think that any of us will differ that India has, right since time immemorial, searched and researched, examined, tested, and framed the rules of life where we can live harmoniously in consonance with the nature. Being a part of the nature, conserving nature, preserving nature, and friendly taking advantage of nature. And for that, I think that our education system, how it addressed our education system in India, in context to India, perhaps if I look at the education system from time immemorial, we had an education system as described in Rig Veda, where we had rishis, we had thinkers, we had hermits, we had vipras, we have legislators, we have poets, we have sages, and they all observed the nature, researched it, tested it time and again, and framed the law of good living, living with harmony, living with people together, not only with people together, but a nature together. The ecological balance they thought of that time, it was the educational research conducted by them. And still, we need to learn it, we need to adopt it, we need to follow it, we need to propagate it, we need to transmit it, and we need to still improve it if possible. Friends, our ancestors have given a Shanti mantra. When we are talking about the sustainability, they have given a Shanti mantra as Om Dhyau Shanti Hai, Antariksha Gom Shanti Hai, Prathavi Shanti Hai, Aapah Shanti Hai, औषधयः शान्तिः, वनस्पतयः शान्तिः, विश्वे देवा शान्तिः, ब्रह्मा शान्तिः, सर्वभूम शान्तिः, शान्तिरेव शान्ति साम शान्तिरोधि, ओम शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति. The English translation of it is, may peace radiate there in the whole universe. In the vast eternal space everywhere, may peace regain all over this earth in water and in all herbs, trees and creepers. May peace regain over the whole universe. May there be peace be in the supreme Brahma, and may there always exist peace and peace alone. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Can there be any better approach or synthesis towards preserving nature, believing in sustainability? Can there be any educator who gives such message? And for that, maintaining such peace, our ancestors have given some principles of life. I quote from Manusmriti, Dhrati Kshama, Damosteham Shochami Indriga Nigraha, Dhi Vidya, Satyam Akrodho Dashakam Dharma Lakshanam. That is patience, forgiveness, contempt, discrimination, non-stealing, purity, control of selves, righteousness, knowledge, truth, and giving up anger. These are the 10 principles of dharma, and dharma is the duty which a person follows. Can there be any other conclusion of any research how man should behave in his life to maintain, to preserve, to conserve, and to keep it as it is, or in a better form for coming generation? It is sustainability. It is the way, it is the education or educational approach for sustainability. This is not only the thing. The purpose of this sustainability is Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu Ma Kashchina Dukh Bhag Bhavet. That is, may all be free from illness. May all be happy. May all see what is auspicious. May no one suffer in any way. Om, peace, peace, peace. Om, Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. It is for every individual. Everyone lives happy, not only in present time, but in future also. I think this is the education. This is the outcome of researches done by scientists, the philosophers, whom we call rishis, munis, tejas, and whatnot. They have given the formula for sustainability and develop direction for development. The ultimate purpose of development, the outcome, if it is missing from these principles, then it is not a sustainable development. And for this, our ancient education system has given many things which, if we just try to collect and discuss, perhaps it may take long time. I have just given you a simple example of it. This conclusion, this recommendation, this way of life, this philosophy came from our earlier ancient education system. And the outcome of educational research in our ancient India. As I mentioned you earlier, that when in context to India it comes, then certainly we need to think it differently. It was in our ancient education system, but in Middle Age, that is when India was under the influence of Islam. Islamic people just invaded India, then the education system changed. Madrasas came into existence. Arabic and Persian was the language to be learned. Quran was taught in the schools. And Arabic and Persian became the language for government appointment or Rajasi appointment in Rajya, that is in government. That time, system of education changed from Gurukul to it came to madrasas. At Gurukul, the role of teacher and disciple were different. Teacher was just maintaining and taking care of all students called shishyas. There was no examination. They were just living with gurus in their ashrams, discussing, and the very thing which was there is really important, which I tell you that Shravan Manan and Ninidhyasan, listen, just think over it and still think over it, discuss it. It was the way, and we came with the concrete outcome of the educational researches. But in case of madrasas, we came in a formal education system. The researches in that direction never happened. The researches were perhaps only for worldly things. There is no much evidence about the researches being conducted during Islamic period in India. The reason being, whatever researches or outcome of researches were available before Islamic period, they were being utilized and they were being applied. Later came the modern era. In modern era, after 1857, or rather still before, East India Company came here. And from the East India Company, it came as a businessman. It was not a ruler, it was not a policy maker. And as a businessman, as a business person, the European evangelist and businessmen propagated their system here, and about 150 years they continued to do business, and later on they just started interfering or rather involving in the education system. As a result, in 1792, Jonathan Duncan opened a college and Sanskrit college in Banaras. Likewise, the supporters of Oriental and Western education differed on what kind of education should be imparted. The debate continued, finally influenced by the logic of Lord Macaulay and the support of Raja Ram Mohan Rai. Lord Bentinck decided to study English language and literature and European history, science, etc. And in this order, Mony approved in the writ of 1813, he spent Oriental education should go on. He emphasized that Oriental education should go on, but the emphasis should also be on studying and teaching English and Western languages. So I just mentioned that that time the businessmen, English businessmen, they just got involved in the education system. And then there's a long history, I'm not going to cover it, but still the up to this point, and even before independence, many educational commissions came, universities were established, educational process, teachers, appointment of teachers, paid teachers, not only examination, tests, vacations, Sunday holiday, all these came into existence. Again, after independence, we all know that, no, you all are from the field of education, almost all are from the field of education, so you know that what education commissions were set up and what are the recommendations, what are the purpose. I need not go into the detailed history of it. But still, from Radhakrishnan Commission to National Education Policy of present time, many education commissions were set up for development of nation, for educating nation. And we see that the level of education in India, as was in English period, was declined. There is a book, A Beautiful Tree. We can see that book. I'm forgetting the name of the author. Oh, yes, Dharmpal, by Dharmpal. A Beautiful Tree by Dharmpal very clearly explains the education system during English period and before it, where there were no formal schools, but there were as many schools as needed, even in the villages. There was no illiterate person. But this English education system, when came into existence, it hampered our education as well as the researches in education. Because I just mentioned that I am talking in context of India. And as a result, when India became independent, the educated, so-called school-going children were very less in percentage, and there was very less percentage of female literacy. Until this moment, we are struggling for it, that we want to go for a literate nation, an educated nation. Today we have more than 800, about 900 universities in India. But still, the research, which is educational research, the research which we can make a man, a holistic man, a man, perfect man, a man as envisaged by Arvindev, a man as envisaged by Vivekanand, a man as envisaged by Vinoba Bhave, by Gandhi, is yet to come out. And it is India. It is India. Fortunately, this new education policy 2020 has come. And it has addressed the problem of present India. And I think you all know that for the first time, for framing this education policy, suggestions were invited from lower to lower end, and lakhs of suggestions were received by the government of India. After studying them, after compiling them, the Kasturi Ranjan Committee prepared a draft, and this wonderful draft in which school education and college education has been taken in totality. It is for the first time. Otherwise, in the earlier commissions, some were devoted to school education, some were partly devoted to higher education, but in this draft, right from early child education, that is Anganwadi, that is pre-school education, nursery education, to higher education at research level, they have given specific recommendations, given a broad spectrum of studies as per the basic talent, basic inclination, basic spirit of a student, where interdisciplinary studies can be taken up. Otherwise, we were studying in the watertight compartment. And as a result, we know that the fertility of mind will express its potential, giving some specific recommendations after learning and churning of the learned matter for the utilization of society, for making this world a sustainable for future generation. I am very happy to say that whatever our ancient literature quotes, believes, propagates, our modern scientists have just probed in identifying, searching, envisaging, or thinking, imagining the Higgs boson, the God particle. Saying that as on today, it is the ultimate particle, which is there in everything in this universe, maybe live or non-living object. I am also happy to mention that earlier we were, our world was in the opinion, world was having opinion that plants doesn't have life, but Jagdish K.C. Bose, Jagdish Chandra Basu has proved that plants do have life. And Higgs boson propagates that even in non-living object, that God's particle is there. And the boson, Bose name given to this particle is an Indian Bose. It is a matter of great pleasure for all of us, and still scientists all over the world say that as on today, it is the ultimate, but it may not be. We may still explore and find some other thing, as our scripture says that neti neti, this also is not, this also is not. Our system helps us to know everything there is in the universe. But we need to search and research it. It is the right time that the NEP, National Education Policy 2020, should be implemented in toto, in its words and spirits, so that we can very successfully ensure the sustainable development for future, the development which is sustainable, our education system can help it. The new education system can help it. The national education policy will certainly open up new vistas for research. I would like to quote some sentences. In the Taittiriya Upanishad 1.6, the process of self-learning and teaching have been emphasized. If one wants to rise his self stature, or if one wants to contribute to the knowledge and welfare of society, or should not neglect self-study and teaching. Ultimately, all the activities must be aimed at creating a healthy society for harmonious living. Martin is also making efforts in that same direction. He is thinking of world constitution. He is envisaging a world government for which Indian education system, Indian scriptures, Indian literature, Indian rishis, they have already given model. They have already given the pathway. But can we at any stage feel that who will be the torch bearer of it? Who will bear the torch? Who will be the torch bearer of this? Friends, I only trust in the teachers. Teachers of present generation, teachers of coming generation, teachers at primary level, teachers at secondary and higher secondary level at higher education, teachers advising their students for research, teachers conducting their own research, researchers. They only can contribute towards educational research. No politician, no bureaucrat, no businessman can ever think of it. They are the beneficiaries. But real work we have to do. It's our responsibility, it's our duty. And Indian context, I appeal all of you, be careful, be aware, be enlightened, study our literature, look into the past, look into the past of the past, and see what direction we have been given, we were given, and that direction will continue to guide our society for coming centuries. The world is looking at us. World is a receiver and India is a giver. Realize our role, realize our potential, be a teacher in its true sense. The way our rishis were the teacher, not the way a salary earning, Sunday waiting, vacations availing teacher is as on today. But the teacher who really thinks, that discusses, that churns the knowledge, comes out with Navneet, that is makhan or butter of it. Navneet is much more of a refined thing of than butter. That will help us, that will help our society. I think my time is over because I have much to say, but time limit is there. If you permit, I can tell you some more things. But if time is over, then I think I should stop it here. Madam Talisra, Madam Tyagi.
Sir, actually, listening to you, we don't feel like saying that it should come to a stop. Because we are really.
I think it is already. Seven.
Please continue. Please continue, sir.
Sir,
please continue.
We should not involve in the jargons which are being played in world today. They will mislead us. They will confuse us. Much time we have wasted in getting ourselves misled and confused. Don't believe in the jargons given by others. Just look at the real concepts given by our rishis. I am sure that even a few of us start working in this direction, perhaps we will be doing a service to society, not only to ourselves, not only to India, but to the world. Today, the world is in the need of peace and harmony. And in every Shanti Mantra, we look at the peace. We talk of the peace. Every great saint of India has propagated peace. And that peace is not a commodity which can be purchased from the market. The peace comes from our inner, and that inner we should explore. That inner we can explore by just reading our scriptures, our Arsh Granths. And everywhere we see that in the world people might be having one or two role models, but in India each of us is having as many role models as he wants in his life. We can enumerate one role model for each day in our whole life. So many number of role models are there. You follow any of them, you will get peace. Will get harmony with the nature. Is there any other culture in this world? Is there any education system in this world which has propagated a culture which respects animals, which respects plants, which respects water, air, even sound? Here, our rishis has suggested us to even chant our mantra within ourselves, so that they are more fruitful. Friends, topic given by Madam Talesra has made me to think in a different context, because she added two words here in Indian context. Had it not been the topic was not covered with Indian context, perhaps I would have been using rhetoric, the words people usually speak, the essays which usually gets published, the researches which are being conducted here and there, and claps which people receive on their delivery by their audience. In Indian context, because being an Indian, knowing the gravity of Indian scholars, Indian teachings, I feel that the Shanti Mantra which I spoke is sufficient. Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Badrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashchantu Bhagbhavi. Can there be anything better than this? Friends, I think still I have taken time. Time is over. I extend my heartiest thanks to all of you for listening me very patiently. And I extend my thanks to Hemlata Madam also. And also apologize, Raghu sir. I don't know what he was planning to present. But I expressed my own views, and I would like to listen to his views also on the topic, right. Maybe on some other day. we would all get benefited from.
Sure.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Sure. Mm.